Okay, this lecture today, number 23, is going to be on an overview of cryptography, a little bit about the role of prime factorization algorithms in resolve, and what is called public key encryption. So we can think of the process of encryption as the following. Suppose you have a sentence here that you, or a paragraph that you want to encrypt. Now, encryption just means making what's called plain text hard to decipher. So you might have a text, the quick brown fox jumped over the lazy dog, so I won't write all that out. But just suffice it to say it's a sentence. So it's a set of characters. So we could start off with a set of characters, T, H, E, space, Q, U, I, C, K, E, R, O, etc. And we want to map that to a new, start off with this S1, we want to map it up to something which is not readily readable. So you can think of this almost as a mathematical problem. If you want to take a function s to s1 dot c, you want to take a function in such a way that it also has an inverse. Because clearly, if you send something, if you're the sender and this is the recipient, you want the recipient to be able to apply a function and recover the original message. Otherwise, it's not very useful to send a secret message if no one else can read it. As some wag did say, that a secret is only a secret if it's only known to one person. As soon as two people know a secret, it's not a secret anymore. And there's some truth to that. Now, usually F will depend on a series of parameters. So it may be a function of X, its input, but it will also be alpha 1, alpha 2, etc. There will be a finite set of parameters. And we require that it is invertible with these parameters in order to recover the original message. So it's just a mapping, the encryption algorithm, it's just a mathematical function that takes a set of ASCII, a subset of ASCII, or a set of ASCII characters, punctuation, etc., encrypts it, transmits it, and unencrypts it at the end. So this process is called encryption, taking the original message and encrypting it, and the opposite, or the inverse, is decryption. Now, one of the earliest ways, and this is actually known in Julius Caesar. So Julius Caesar, actually when he was transmitting messages to his generals, he would take a message and do a shift cipher, which is a very primitive one. It would almost certainly be decoded instantly nowadays. He just took A and added several characters. So if you added characters, say 3, this becomes a D, 3 becomes an E, C becomes an F. So you just add 3 and shift the alphabet. So you take the alphabet A, B, C, D to Z, and then repeat it again, A, B, C, etc. And you just shift each character by a fixed amount, and then wrap around. So this is very, in fact, these are what you probably see these in Cracker Jack. These are the decoder rings. It was the Captain Midnight decoder rings, where you take the alphabet and you just twist it by a certain amount and you just read off, you know, on your ring the secret message and stuff. But these can obviously, because there's only one simple parameter here, these are very easily unencrypted. Decrypted. But these were used historically by Julius Caesar. So again, the way I think of encryption is a mapping just between a character set and a subset of that, this, and itself, which takes the characters S1 and maps it to another set S2. So it's important, I mean, one way to do it is just to take a one-to-one correspondence. In other words, you take A and you map it to Q, and you take B and you map it to something other than Q. You don't want to map two things onto one, because then obviously the mapping won't be one-to-one. So you could, in fact, take A and just map it to Q. You could take B and map it to E, and C and map it to Z, etc. So really what you're doing is just taking a list of the numbers, or letters, A through Z, copying it, and just setting up a one-to-one correspondence. So C, for example, goes to Z, and Z might go to B, etc. So as long as the map corresponds as one-to-one, it's able to be unencrypted. Now, more nowadays, things are not done so trivially, and in fact, the message that you encrypt is often much smaller than the encrypted message. The encrypted message can be quite large relative to the message, so that it's harder to do frequency counts and other ways of unencrypting message. If you have a one-to-one correspondence, then that preserves the frequency of letters and sentences, and since you know the statistical frequency of, say, the vowels and Z's and T's, you can match that up with the statistical frequency of your encoded message, and that allows you to unencrypt things fairly quickly with such a simple encryption algorithm. Now, one of the earliest methods involved a key, and so pretty much what you have here is you can have a symmetric encoding, or a symmetric algorithm, and that is you take your message here, your set of characters, and you take a key, and you encrypt it, so you have gobbledygook. How do you spell gobbledygook? Okay, so you have an unreadable message, and then you transmit that with the key to your recipient, and then you get back your original message. But this kind of begs the question is, if your transmission path is not secure, in other words, you're not physically carrying this key in a briefcase to some diplomatic embassy overseas, if you're transmitting the key, if someone captures the key, they can unencrypt your messages. So this algorithm, a symmetric algorithm where you have to use the same key to encrypt and unencrypt, that begs the question of how secure your transmission is. And if your transmission of the key is not very good, then that is lays this all open to insecurity. So this is only as good as the transmission of the key, or the only as good as the security of the transmission of the key. Okay, so in fact, there's a PGP algorithm that we'll talk about later, which actually does a very secure method for doing the key, and then that key, and then a less secure way of using the key with a symmetric approach to do a fast. Now, symmetric approach is very fast, so the advantages are it's very fast. I'll put fast in capital letters because it really is fast. The disadvantage, and I'll put that up here, the disadvantage is it's only good as the security of the transmission available for the key. So if you're transmitting the key over the internet, then and someone captures it, then you have to encode the key itself. And this is, looking at both of these disadvantages, you can do one of two things. One is to have an asymmetric method. And this was the basis of the PGP algorithm. And that's an example, since there are other methods. So in 1976, a group of computer scientists, mathematicians named Hellman and Diffie proposed a public key encryption, in which case they split the public and the private keys. So now there are two keys. There's a public key, which everybody in the world knows, and there's a private key, which only one person is supposed to know. And the way this works is, if you have a message, you take your private key and you encode it. Then at the recipient end, you take the encoded message and then they apply your public key to it and then unencrypt it. So then you have the public key and then you have your original message again. Now, everybody in the world can have your public key because some people post it in their email or, you know, PGP key. You know, it's actually, they send it all around. Now, this public key will only work with your private key. So if someone else encodes a message and you attempt to use the wrong public key on it, you're just going to get gobbledygook. So only this public key will only work for your private key. So this splitting the key into two pieces is what makes the asymmetric so quick. Now, the PGP algorithm actually is a little bit more complex than this, because it uses the public and private key, but it also has to do with the transmission of the public key and all that kind of stuff. And there is a detailed description of the PGP algorithm in some of the references at the end of the lecture. But the important thing is there are now two keys. So if I wanted to encrypt a message to a recipient, then I get my message, I take my private key, I encode it, send it to you along with my public key, and then only you can decode it. If I want to encrypt something with a private key, it can be decrypted or unencrypted using the public key, but by no other key. One of the ways that this is used is a so-called digital signature. If I send a message to you, and you can unencrypt it or decrypt it with my public key, that basically guarantees that I sent it or that someone sent it with my private key. Now, I cannot rule out the fact that someone else could have gotten a hold of my private key and sent you a check for $10 million, you know. So it's very important in these that the private key remain private. Once it's out, then it's basically worthless. So a digital signature is only as good as the security of how private you keep your private key. And often people will put it on a floppy disk or lock it in a safe or, you know, just keep it as secure as physically secure as possible. Now, also, if I distribute a public key and someone else, well, if you fake it, you can claim to be someone else, generate a public-private key combination, and if that other person thought that I was that person, someone else, I could then, in his eyes, authenticate communication. So, in some sense, security is only as good as how much you trust the sender. Now, this is where things called certificate authorities have gotten started. So the problem is do you trust the sender? So the problem is, do you trust the sender? Well, and this is sometimes called the man in the middle problem. The man in the middle. Because suppose here you are, you're the sender, and here is the receiver, and you want to send over something really secure. Now, if you've never had any traffic before, a third person, the man in the middle, MIM, he could then send you a public key that he claims came from him. And he also has a private key, and until you can verify that this person, the sender, is who's actually sent, this is the problem, is when you get an electronic message, did it come from the sender or did it come from someone else? Now, this is where something called a certificate authority was developed. And these are fairly complex, but what a certificate authority does is guarantee that the identity of the sender. So if this sender has a certificate from a certificate authority, such as VeriSign or FOTT or any of the other ones, Microsoft or any of the other certificate authorities, this person basically has to give phone number, they have to give the name of their boss, they have to give their work. I mean, there's a whole lot of things, almost short of a site visit, that they have to do to guarantee that they are who, in fact, they are. And once they do that, once the identity of the person requesting the certificate is assured, then that person gets a certificate. And this person cannot get that certificate unless they physically steal the certificate from their machine. So obviously you need to keep the digital certificates in an encrypted form that only you can understand and use. But if this message comes over with a digital certificate plus a PGP encrypted message with a public-private key, you're basically as confident that it's a legitimate message as you are confident that this person is who they say they are. In other words, how much do you believe the certificate authority? Now, current certificate authorities are actually mostly hierarchical. So I have a hierarchical certificate authority, meaning that the sender has a certificate which was issued by a certificate authority. But this certificate authority also is validated by another certificate authority going all the way up here to some top-level certificate authority. And these certificate authorities at the top basically allow bunches of people to get authenticated down here. And there's very few people at the top level. At the very top level of the issuing tree, there's just a handful of companies. So for example, here's an example of what you have to go through to get a 128-bit super certificate from FOTT, which is a certificate authority. And it's just a checklist, and I think there's actually a flow chart associated with this. Yeah, I'll give you an idea of the kind of information that you need. So here, what do I need to get a certificate? So that's on page 9. Okay, here's a step-by-step process. And it's pretty lengthy. And let's just see if we can... Okay, so this is just getting your environment up and being secure. Like, do you have a web environment? No. Well, you have to get a web server, host name, domain name, install the server software, et cetera. And then you just go down through this checklist about verifying the support, have you faxed the supporting documentation. I mean, IRS records, Social Security records, job employment, they go and they actually, to get one here at A&M, they will call somebody at the university, either Pierce Cantrell in CIS or the Vice President for Research or somebody, to authentic that a request came from a member in their, you know, they'll say, well, Mike Pilon has wanted a certificate, you know, does he work for you, how long has he worked for you, you know, do you have information on this guy? So they're very complicated, and they do their best to make sure you really are the USAR. A VeriSign, again, is a link to another blue chip certificate, or a very top level certificate. And they give it for business, e-business, small businesses, email certification, all kinds of stuff. Now you can also, there are tools out there that allow you to certify yourself, and I've actually done this, and I've given myself a certificate that just says that I guarantee myself from myself. In other words, I issue a certificate from myself to myself saying that I am who I am. So you can take that with whatever you want. I'd certainly take it with a grain of salt. If you want to see a list of trusted certificate authorities in Explorer, you can go up to Tools, Internet Options, then you go up into Content, Certificates, and Trusted Root. So you see a bunch of ABA.com, there's some Spanish ones, Baltimore, Easy, CNW, CA1, CertiSign, the VeriSigns there, some German ones in there, Equifax. So there's a whole bunch. Even Microsoft has its own root. So if you click on that, you could actually probably even look at the certificate. It's in encoded X509 format. If you want to see one under Mozilla, which is probably what you're running, go under Edit, Preferences, and then click on Privacy and Security, and then Certificates, Manage Certificates, and then look at Authorities. So you can actually see what people your browser trusts, and these are actually built in to the binary, so they've been authenticated, and their certificates by the makers of the browser, and they're basically bundled automatically, so unless you hack the source code of Mozilla or Explorer, which is probably hard to do, you could not mess around with the authentication of the certificates. Now the PGP algorithm, and PGP in Linux, almost everything is an acronym, so PGP stands for Pretty Good Privacy, and it's basically almost state of the art. It is now a commercial product, even though you can get it for basically all the tools for free. But it has thousands of corporations and millions of users, and there's a lot of tools and toolkits and things like that. There's an international PGP site with lots of very nice links. So if you go up here on documentation, there's 100 documentation links. So, for example, if you go to Frequently Asked Questions, there's 15 different links on here. Here's things on PGP questions and answers, passphrase, FAQs, how secure is PGP. There's an FAQ on cryptography. Oops, that looks apparently broken. And how easy it is to get PGP, can you put in back doors or traps and things like that. So that's a lot of references there. What I'd like to talk today is a part of the PGP algorithm that is built, part of it that actually does the encryption is an RSA algorithm. Now we've talked about this before. The RSA algorithm consists of the following steps. You first find two very large primes. And modern ones are at least 128, preferably 512 or even 1024. It's anticipated that if you have fairly strong prime numbers, and I'll tell you what that means in a second, that it would take you longer to break the RSA encryption by factorization algorithm than the lifetime of the universe, even with all known computing power at your disposal. So if you can find two very large primes, roughly the same order, roughly 1024 bits themselves, that's roughly, you get about 3 bits per decimal place, say. So this is roughly a 200 to 300 decimal digit prime. And, I mean, there's quite a lot of primes. We've seen that the distribution of primes is roughly like log n. So between any two decimal intervals, there's basically a huge number of primes. So then you choose a number e, which is bigger than 1, but less than the product of these, such that e and this number, p minus 1, q minus 1 product, are relatively prime, which means they have no prime factors in common. Now, the primes are odd, so this is definitely even. So if you pick a prime, you just see if that prime number e will divide this. And if not, then there's no prime factors in common. So e doesn't have to be prime, but it has to be an odd number because p minus 1, q minus 1 is even. So once you've found a number e and a p and a q and the product p times q, that combination becomes your public key. So pq, which is the product of these, and e is the public key. Now, under no circumstances do you give out p and q separately. You basically compute pq and then you throw away p and q. Because if you know P or Q, basically the whole scheme is compromised. So once you calculate another number D, so that D times E minus 1 is divisible by this, and then there's a very simple, you just find an integer D so that D is an integer times P minus 1, Q minus 1, plus 1. So you just calculate that number for various choices of X until you get an integer, and then you use that value of D. So this is a very simple step. So the encryption basically just takes your message T, raises it to your power E, which is your number E here that you've picked, part of your public key, and then mod PQ. And then the decryption function uses this D, which is a private key. So D is private, it's not to reveal it to anyone. PQ is public, it's called the modulus, and E is the public exponent. Now, if you could publish the product PQ, if you could factor it into two primes, then your key could be broken, because if you know P and Q separately, you could then just go through this algorithm again, come up with E, and hence D through trial and error very quickly. So once you can factor your public key, the algorithm is compromised. So the algorithm is only as good as the ability to factor a huge 300-digit number into two very large primes. And that takes a long time. In fact, you can estimate essentially how long it will take. Now here's an example of the RSA with specific things. P 61, Q is 53. These are two-digit primes. The product is 3,233, the product of P and Q. I picked 17 to be prime with respect to this because it is prime. And then I calculate B, which is my private exponent. I give out the numbers 3,233, P times Q, and E, which is 17. I then take my message T, which is, say, 1, 2, 3. I raise it to my power E, which is public, and mod it with respect to PQ. So that is basically publicly available. I then decrypt it by taking the result of this and applying the secret exponent and modding it with respect to my public key. So here's an example. If you encrypt 123, you're taking 123 raised to the 17th power modulo 323, and you can see these are actually fairly large numbers, and you calculate 855. Then you put 855 into the unencryption, the inverse function. You raise 855 to the 2753rd power, which is a huge number. Mod it with respect to 3233, you get back your original three digits. So you may say, boy, this is an awful lot of work to encrypt three numbers. And you're right. But there are very fast ways, and this is an example of how you can compute large, using large arithmetic, arbitrary precision arithmetic. For example, if you want to calculate 855 raised to these various powers, the modulus arithmetic helps you out. So in fact, 855 raised to the 2753 mod 3233 is actually this number. That's a big number. So take all these decimals, that's always bigger than your integer on your computer. And then you take that mod 3233 and you recover your initial message. 1, 2, 3. Now, in fact, you do want to avoid patterns. So often what you're going to do is you're going to take your message and you're going to compress it by some lossless compression scheme. So this might be zip or gzip or bzip2. And these are in roughly an order of goodness here. The zip is an older algorithm, which is actually has a patent on it by Unisys, so people don't use zip anymore, or why Windows does, because they pay the licensing fee. Gzip is the GNU version of zip, and bzip2 is the next generation. And there's an unzip, a gunzip, and a bunzip that undo this. So these are all lossless compression. Now, one nice side effect is that two things. The message is smaller, fewer bytes, and it has fewer patterns. Because all compression schemes basically rely on identifying patterns and replacing those patterns by tables, table lookups. So if you look at the statistical properties of a compressed set of binary data, it basically has no discernible patterns. And that prevents people from cracking your code based on pattern recognition. So you now have a message which is smaller and patternless, almost pattern-free. You then take that message and you generate a key. Well, a separate thing is you generate a key. And you might even generate a one-time key. So if you really want to be secure, you generate a one-time key. Now you take that one-time key and you encrypt this compressed message. So this generates a public and a private. You then take that key and then you generate also, this is an ASIC, you can also generate a symmetric encryption key. And then what you can do is you can take the key and you take the message and you encrypt the message. And you can encrypt the key, and so it would have key sub E for encrypted and message sub E for this. And you bundle this up, and you send it over here. You then unencrypt the key and use the key to generate the public key and then unencrypt the message. So there's actually a fairly high degree of security here, and I'm not explaining it in 100% unambiguous fashion. But you separate, you can generate a one-time key. That means you never ever use it again. And there's an infinite number of primes. In fact, there's a huge number of primes, you know, that have 300 digits. So if you generate a bunch of these prime pairs, you can the chances of someone else generating a prime pair the same as yours is negligible. Because these primes, or if you look in the codes, the primes are actually generated by the, if you enter in a passphrase, it takes the time in milliseconds between your keystrokes, takes the time in numbers of seconds from the year 1900 and a whole bunch of other stuff, and generates a prime number out of that. So the odds on someone else typing exactly the same thing at exactly the same rate at exactly the same time is non-existent. So you can generate a one-time prime key very, very securely, and unless they somehow capture your keystrokes and capture the prime computation, it will be secure. Then they split the message and the key, and they use the key to encrypt the message, and then they encrypt the key, and then they send the key, encrypted key, and the encrypted message to someone, and they then unencrypt the key, and then unencrypt the message. So in fact, they use a key which is a symmetric key, which is fast, like the DES encryption. So in fact, you could do a DES encryption key, and then encrypt this by PGP. So you actually will put a public key and a private key. You use your private PGP key to encrypt the DES key, and then someone at the other end uses your public PGP key to unencrypt the key for the symmetric key for the DES, and then they use that to unencrypt the message very quickly, because the PGP encryption is much slower than the DES encryption. Okay, so this is basically how the PGP works. Now, there are references down here with literally hundreds of pages of PDF files. So if you want to look under here, overview of PGP, for example, the third one. And then there's a PDF documentation. Okay, that's actually where we were. Overview of PGP. Oh, that is literally where we were. Let's get back. You might wonder how good it is. So I actually looked up. There's a challenge here, RSA, which is the commercial company. It did have a patent on the RSA algorithm, but that expired in 2000, so they made it public domain. But they will give you, this company, if you can factor this prime, and not prime, if you can't factor the prime, if you can factor this 174 or 574 binary digits, if you can factor this number into product of two primes, they'll write you a check for $10,000. And it's currently not factored. If you can factor this prime, which has 193 digits, slightly bigger, you'll get $20,000. All the way down to the bottom, if you factor this puppy, 2,048 binary digits, which is 617 decimal digits, if you can factor this into roughly two equal primes, or just two primes, period, they'll write you a check for $200,000. Now, they figure that's a good deal because probably it would take you $200,000 or more of computer time and Cray time over all the machines you could get your hands on in the world for the next umpteenth years to factor this composite number. The prime factorization is judged to be so hard that this 2048 digit key, binary digit key, they figured it would take probably, with current technology, it would take longer than the universe will be around to factor it. Now here's a nice Java applet that I found that demonstrates sort of how this works. So it gives you three applets. It gives you a way to generate a key. It then gives you a way to type in the message, and then you can actually see. No, I don't want to calculate N and E and D myself, so I'm just going to generate a new key. Okay, so here's my N, there's my E. So N, remember, is the product of two primes. And the D is my secret key. Now, in order to encrypt it, I have to enter the N, and I'm going to cheat. I'm just going to Control-C, Control-V. Let me generate another one. Control-C, I'll put in N. I'll then put in the E. And then I'm going to enter in plain text. So I'm going to say, the quick brown fox jumped over the lake, and then I'm going to capitalize dog and put some ellipsis there. Okay, so now I have my two combinations of my N and my E. Then I'm going to say encrypt plain text. Okay, so here is the encrypted plain text. And it's actually in chunks of these digits here. So each of these is a chunk. Now I'm going to unencrypt it, meaning I'm going to Control A, Control C. I'm going to copy that encrypted plain text, which this looks like garbage. I'm going to enter in my N. And again, I'm just cutting and pasting because I don't want to take a chance on mistyping. And I'm going to enter in my private key, D, from the first one. And then I'm going to say hit, and then that's how fast it unencrypts it. So if somebody were monitoring your transmission on an encrypted line, this is the gobbledygook they would get by your keystrokes. And basically, these algorithms are done so fast now that it's basically real-time encryption. I mean, much Ethernet traffic is going out at 100 megabits per second, and it's actually doing that encryption in real-time, block by block. Now, if you wanted to change this, now, suppose I entered in the wrong key. Suppose I entered in 5 instead of 3 there, and I attempt to unencrypt it. It doesn't make any sense. Okay, so this is a nice little algorithm. You can generate, every time you click a button, you generate a new public-private key. Well, what happens is if they use your public key to encrypt the message to you, you can unencrypt it with your private key, which only you know. So what you do is you use the other person's public key to encrypt the message to them. Because you need the public, and you don't want to ever transmit your private key to them, because once you do that, it's insecure. You always keep your private key on your machine, say on a floppy or something, you know, or somehow buried on your machine in a way that you can't physically get compromised. Then you use their public key to encrypt a message to them. When it gets there, they use their public key or their private key, just like I did here, to unencrypt your message to them. So this was the breakthroughs when they split the keys into two pieces. It meant that you never had to actually physically transmit the private key around. And all you needed was the public key to encrypt it, and they needed a private key. And if you used their public key, they would need their private key to encrypt it. Now, if you did it to a third person, say, suppose I use your public key to encrypt a message to someone else, they would not be able to unencrypt it. Unless they had your private key. That's why if they somehow intercept the traffic between us, it really doesn't do them any good unless they can. And if the encryption, if when it leaves your machine, it's all compressed and encrypted, then basically they've got nothing but an undecipherable set of binary digits to grab. Now you might say, well, this is a perfect system, right? The problem is there could be other ways of breaking the RSA encryption algorithm besides just factoring the prime numbers. In fact, there's apparently what's called a timing attack. If they can observe your system encrypting, in other words, if they can calculate how long it takes for a message to be encrypted on your system, with enough messages, just the timing information gives them bounds and other things on the sizes of the primes so that they can actually deduce information by watching your system on basically make an educated guess. And if you have enough constraints, then the prime factorization can be much better. Like, for example, if you know this number has two primes and those primes are between certain bounds, then the prime factorization might go very quickly. So people are always trying to crack these, but the way of breaking, and it's an open question, no one knows how hard factorizing primes is. I mean, people believe that prime factorization is not polynomial. Although there's some, I have a paper, it's in the Focus, that says that a new primal screen claims to be polynomial in time. It says, these three researchers in India Institute of Technology posted an algorithm that decides if a given number is prime or composite in the number of steps bounded by the 12th power of the digits being tested. And actually, they give a reference to it. You can actually type it in. Didn't see this before class. So this is actually a reference that's supposed to be polynomial in time for deciding whether something is prime factorable or not. See if that gets me there. And I'll put a link to this if it successfully gets there. And these are actually graduate students. In fact, two of them were undergraduates last spring. So this is just about younger than the age of some of the people in here. So I'll, let's see. Let's bump this up again. So it says, the paper says in the abstract, we present a deterministic polynomial time algorithm that determines whether an input number n is prime or composite. Okay, so that's apparently a major breakthrough in this business. Now, there is I put a link in here into various prime factorization algorithms. If you look at the bottom of this article, you'll see a whole bunch of things. Brent's factorization methods, Dixon's factorizations, elliptic curves, prime factorizations, the quadratic sieve, etc. The two best methods that are currently known are these two that are listed down here at the bottom. The quadratic sieve algorithm, which you can then read a little bit more about from this MathWorld article, and the number theory, or the number field sieve algorithm. And the number sieve algorithm actually factored RSA 130, which is significantly smaller than the RSA challenge one, which, remember, began with RSA 576, which is roughly the fourth power bigger. Now, just a little plug, there are three math classes, actually. Bob Roikley has an undergraduate, Communications and Cryptography. They use the text mathematical ciphers, and this is the content catalog description. And there are two graduate courses on information secrecy and authentication. The first one's going to be taught this fall. Now, I actually have found at least one little snippet of C code that actually works, but the problem is, it's a direct, if you go down here at the very bottom, Let's see, this is Visual Basic, and here is the C code. So here's a very simple implementation of the C code, but you'll see the very the problem with this, and I actually compiled it and ran it. The problem is it has a very small list of primes. In fact, there are only 13 of primes in this code, up to 43. Now the problem is when you do this exponentiation down here, that's part of the code. Where is it? Here it is. When you compute this power, m raised to the e power, it is much bigger than a long integer. You saw how huge those powers were, and basically they overflow. So unless you have an arbitrary precision arithmetic package, you really can't do the RSA encryption algorithm in C. However, there are references. The GNU has a arbitrary precision integer arithmetic package that you can actually download. There's a book which I would recommend. This is sort of the Bible of cryptography by this Buschmeier. And this is a second edition of it, and this is like the handbook of cryptography. There's a great introduction to it. It said there are two kinds of algorithms. There are algorithms that will keep your files from being read by your kid sister, and there are algorithms that will keep your files from being read by major governments employing supercomputers. He said this book is concerned about the latter. So it's kind of an interesting preface. And then again, there's two PDF documents that I found useful. This one is called An Introduction to Cryptography, and this is printed or put out by PGP International, so it's accessing it from an FTP site. Now, while that's downloading, I'll just make one final comment. The reason why the encryption algorithms work so well, or are so efficient, and so much used, is that if I have a large composite number, so if I have a number n, which I know is the product of two primes, and this might be 500 plus digits, it's relatively easy to determine if it's a prime or not. I mean, suppose part of the algorithm is you've got to find two large primes, P and Q, and then multiply them together. Well, how do you determine very quickly, randomly, a prime with 512 binary decimals, right? There's a lot of them, but if you just pick one at random, you can determine whether a number is prime or not. And because, I mean, there are log n primes between 0 and n, so if you pick enough of them, you're statistically quite likely to get a prime. So if you can determine if a number is composite, then you just throw it away and try again. And now you've determined whether something is a prime or very highly probable to be a prime. You can use that as one of the factors. So it's very easy to come up with P's and Q's that generate your public key and private key. And the modular arithmetic is so fast that you can actually do it in real time. What is slow about this is it's easy to determine if it's a prime, but it's hard to factor it if you know it isn't a prime. If it is not. And this is the basis of cryptography. It is not known. There is no algorithm right now, although it isn't proved that there cannot be. It is not known if there is an algorithm that will allow you to factor a composite number in polynomial time. But even if there is, you just make the numbers bigger and, you can. The nice thing about these RSA encryption algorithms is, okay, if 128 bit key doesn't work anymore, you move to a 256 or a 512 or a 1028 or a 2048 or bigger. Because it's still relatively easy to generate primes, it's just very hard to factor them. Okay, I'm going to end this now and just point you to some references and these, particularly the PDF files that we have here. And then there's one other PDF file that's in here. This is actually the biggest one. This is 269 pages, and it does go through the mathematical concepts using modular arithmetic, groups, fields, rings, and it also has readings about how hard it is to encrypt and things like that. So that'll